I hear all these preachers name it, grab it, speak it, claim it, and all of that. Friend, that's not right. That's not of God. Amen. You give everything you got to them, you'll be broke.
Amen.
But friend, if you give everything you have to God as far as your life's concerned, amen, He'll bless.
Amen.
He'll prosper. You'll be successful in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Is that all right?
Amen.
Amen. I'm talking about the barrel of blessings. Boy, I could go on all night talking about this barrel of blessings. Now let me get down to where we live. How much meal do you got in your barrel? Again, I'm not talking physically. Understand what I'm saying. I'm talking spiritually. How much meal is in your barrel? How much oil is in your cruise? What do you got? If you ain't got very much, just bring what you got to me. You can't offer God that you don't have.
That's right.
You can't give God that you don't have. Amen. But just give God what you have. That's all He wants. Amen. My life's shattered. My life's broken. I don't have much to give God. Well, just give Him the pieces. Amen. Give Him the pieces. Amen. Just give Him the pieces. And He'll be satisfied with that. Amen. And in the end, you'll be glad you did. Preacher. What are you talking about? What are you trying to preach to us? God's trying to help me to preach to us about the barrel of blessings. Your life in your hand ain't much. You can't do much with it. But give it to the Master. He can do a lot with it. I read a poem one time. A lot of you's probably heard this poem. And I'm not going to quote this poem verbatim because, to be honest, I can't remember it all. Amen. But I used to see his poem, and some of you know what I'm talking about, and some of you probably remember it, and some of you may even have it in your homes hanging up on the wall somewhere or something. Amen. But there used to be a poem, and again, I'm not going to quote it verbatim. Amen. But I'm going to do my best, amen, to paraphrase, amen, what I'm trying to speak unto us. They say it, and some of you will look at me and grin and shake your head because you'll know what I'm talking about. In this poem, there was an auction going on. Big old auction going on. Items was coming out after item. They were being sold in that auction. Item after item going through. And those items was being sold. But then they come upon a certain item that's not being sold. Nobody wants it. Everybody said, just pass it on by. Let it go on by. I don't want it. It was a fiddle. It was a fiddle. Oh, it didn't look too good. It was old. It was rugged. Amen. It had been beat up and abused or mistreated. It hadn't been took care of. Amen. Maybe even had a hole or two in it. Amen. Maybe having some thin places where it had been beaten all of that. Friend, it didn't look good at all. Nobody wanted that old fiddle. Amen. It looked like just a piece of old junk. Amen. That was fit for the trash. Nobody wanted that fiddle. They were saying, pass it on by. Then there was a man in that auction that came up front, picked that fiddle up, set that fiddle up, began to tune that fiddle, and began to chord that fiddle, and began to take that bow and play the most beautiful music you've ever heard from that old, abandoned fiddle. Amen. A while ago, nobody wanted it. Just pass on by. We don't want that fiddle. It's fit for the trash. Look how it's beat up and banged up. We don't want that. But now, it's in the Master's hand. That's what the title of that poem is, the Master's hand. And he's a playing, he's taking that bow, and he's according that after he set it up, and he's a making the most beautiful music in the world. And everybody is fascinated by that old fiddle. And now, every hand's going up in the auction building, and they're saying, 500, 1,000, 1,500, 2,000, 2,500, sold for $3,000. Hallelujah. I mean, what happened? What happened? It was placed in the Master's hands, and it became more valuable, more precious, and more sacred than it ever was before.
Amen.
What's that got to do with anything, preacher? My life in my hands ain't valuable. It ain't precious.
Amen.
It ain't sacred. Your life in your hand is the same. It's not valuable. It's not sacred. Amen. There's no greatness in your own life that you can brag on. But friend, If we give our life to God, if we give our life to the Master, well, glory! I said, if we give our life to the Master, amen, let Him work in our life. He can make the fifth subject for the kingdom of God. He can make a vessel of honor. And in the end, we'll be glad we gave ourselves to Him.
Amen.
Like I brought up just a moment ago, those few fishes and those few loaves was just one schoolboy's lunch. One little schoolboy's lunch. Enough only for him. But when it was transferred out of his hand into the disciples' hands, it didn't change, did it? It was transferred out of that little schoolboy's hands. But even after it was transferred out of his hands into the disciples' hands, it still wasn't enough for 5,000 people, not counting the women and the children. Peter got a hold of it. It still didn't increase. John got a hold of it. It was still the same. Bartholomew got a hold of it. Nothing changed. It still wasn't sufficient. Still wasn't enough. They gave it to Luke, the physician. Luke couldn't do nothing with it to increase it. It still wasn't sufficient. They passed it throughout all 12 of those disciples, and none of them could change the fact that there wasn't enough to provide the need of that great crowd. I'm going to shout right here, though. I don't know who transferred it from that boy. I don't know which disciple got it from that boy. And I don't know which disciple transferred it to Jesus. But after the last disciple had it in his hand, you know what he done? He transferred it to Jesus. And Jesus blessed it and broke it and gave thanks unto God. And the Bible said, when it was in his hand, it was enough. It was sufficient. It was more than enough. Your empty barrel may not be enough, but if you give it to God, He'll make more than enough.
Amen.
I preached here Sunday night. We don't operate too well on empty. Jacob, when the gas can gets going over on that egg in my vehicle, I start searching for a gas station. Anybody with me?
Yeah.
When my stomach starts getting aware on me, I start hunting for a refrigerator or a restaurant. Amen. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Y'all can tell that, can't you? Amen. Don't worry, don't worry. One day, every one of you is going to look like me. Amen. No, I'm joking. But, friend, it wasn't enough for everybody until they transferred it to Jesus.
That's right.
We don't operate too well with empty. I know I don't. I don't operate well with empty. But God does. He can take an empty vessel and fill it up. Did you realize before God can fill you up with His glory and His power and His prestige, before God can fill you up with His joy and His attributes, before God can fill you up with His love, you got to first empty yourself of the world. You got to first empty yourself of religion. You got to first empty yourself of everything that you know and everything that you have before God can fill you up. Is it worth it, preacher? Is it worth it, preacher? Is it worth it, preacher? 1,000 times, yes. 1,000 times, yes! It's well worth it.
Amen.
It's well worth it. It's well worth it. Church members will mistreat you. Amen. Family will mistreat you. Amen. Folks will abuse you and take advantage of you. But you bring everything you got to Jesus, and He'll bless you.
Yes.
He'll bless you. He'll bless you. He'll bless you. He'll bless you. He really will. He really will. He'll bless you. He'll bless you. He'll bless you. I'm not a rich person. I'm not a rich person. Quite the contrary. Amen. I've been raised poor all my life and I'm still poor. So God voted me in as pastor due to my income and my tithes and offerings. You're liable to get disappointed. I'm going to pay my tithes and offerings. But if you voted me in for my money and stuff, you're probably going to get disappointed. Amen. Is that all right?
Amen.
Amen. But that's not what we do, and that's not why we do what we do. Do you realize at the end of our life, we're all going to be the same? It don't matter how much money you got or how much money you don't got. It don't matter having what you've acquired in this life or what you didn't acquire. Everything you got's going to be left behind. It's not going with you, brother and sister. Amen. Fine homes, riches, big bank accounts, and all of that. Amen. After you're a long time gone, you know what will happen? Amen. It'll be left behind for somebody to fight and dispute over. But friend, I'm telling you, the only thing that's going to matter in the end is where we stand with God. That's my question to everybody here at the Rooty Branch Church. I'm not interested in anything else except for this. Where do you stand with God?
Amen.
It's what I'm interested in. Well, I'm young. I'm younger. You may even be middle-aged or old and think you've still got time and still got many days left here on the earth. I'll never forget preaching revival sometime back, and I'm coming to a close. If anybody needs to pray, this altar's already open. If you're a Christian carrying a heavy burden or a load, come up here and empty yourself. Give it to God. Give it to God. If you're a Christian and you need to pray about anything, this altar's open for you. If you're lost or backslidden and you need God in your heart, this altar's open for you. Why don't you come? While I'm still talking, the altar's open. You're not going to interrupt. Brother and sister, you're going to be a blessing to this service. If you need to pray about anything, come on right now. Come on right now while I tell what I'm about to tell. Amen. Don't worry about who's around you. If you got somebody around you and you want to take them by the hand and say, I need to get out of here and I need to go up to that altar, I want you to go with me. Amen. Take them by the hand and drag them up here with you. Amen. If you need to pray, this altar's open. This altar's open. While I'm telling this, if anybody wants to come and pray, just come on. Come on. But what I'm telling us is, I was preaching revival some time ago. This church was just I've done a lot of preaching in homes. I like preaching in homes. I like good cottage prayer meetings and services like that. I've done a lot of it over the years. And I preached in storefront buildings. I preached in big churches. I preached in small churches. I preached in all types. On this experience, I was preaching in the church that most folks wouldn't identify it as a church. It didn't have no steep one top, didn't have no padded pews or fancy carpet. I mean, it wasn't what, I mean,